Main Drain Cave is located near Tony Grove Lake in northern Utah. It's at an elevation of nearly 9,000 feet. Once up the mountain, you descend over 1,200 feet to what's currently the base level. It's just one of many caves in Tony Grove area, but it's by far the largest, and it appears to serve as the main drain for groundwater flowing through all of them. Dike traces have established a connection to Wood Camp Spring, which is about 6 miles to the south and nearly 3,000 feet lower in elevation. The tremendous cave potential here has made it worth the effort, despite the challenges of alpine cave diving.
So, we are in what I would call a tributary, a tiny little tributary. It may have been too early to have named this Main Drain, because we're not in Main Drain. We're in a little teeny outlying section of the main system. The Sump is the closest spot to the main system. So when we dive this, our goal is to try to, and we hope, that it's just gonna go down and we're gonna come back up into the main system. And best case scenario is they'll find some way to drain water off. It's blocked somewhere, it's a rimstone dam, it's something. And they'll be able to drain water off and we'll get through without having to dive.
There's a couple guys that have been in there, the Thornton brothers, did a dive in there, so they had a little bit of information to pass on to us. We got that information so we can sort of plan based on that. They did say that it was trending downward, so we have a plan of not exceeding 180 feet deep. But really, you just have to have contingency planning. You have to be able to change on the fly.
I contacted Gene when the first divers kind of just said they weren't going to be involved. I'm betting on people that I know have those skills that are necessary to get into the bottom of the cave and get gear to the bottom of the cave.
It started with, it was actually Jason Belensky that knew Swede and said, hey, there's this cave diver in Texas that's been doing some stuff. And so we got in contact and I came out here and about a year ago and went in the cave for the first time and I thought, no way. No way are we going to pull off a Sump dive in a cave like this.
Were you trying to get crazy with this, eh? Don't you know I'm loco?
Heard about this cave for years and have always wanted to see it, so I thought, wow, this is a great opportunity to go see it but also contribute to a project. And so it was neat to be able to help out hauling gear in but also get a chance to see, you know, a really spectacular alpine cave. But it starts out with a really nice entrance pit that has a snow cone inside of it, maybe about 200 feet deep total, and at the bottom there's a lot of ice. It's a cold trap, and then you go up into a climb that has all the air funneled into it. It's really chilly there, but the airflow is impressive. And as you work your way down into the cave, there's a couple of big drops. Like one's about 300 feet deep, Frey Knot, and then Kilo Pit is over 200 feet. So it's an alpine cave that drops you down to the base level pretty quickly. It's rigged European style with rebelays, so it's kind of a jungle gym on ropes, which is fun. And it's pleasant cave because it's really not that muddy. There's not really any tight spots, except that it's pleasant, but it's serious because it's cold and with all the vertical. But it's nice not to be squeezing or wallowing in mud like many alpine caves.
This one, there's a lot more challenges. First of all, it's very vertical. You've got to hike up to the entrance. We're at altitude. It's cold. You have to carry your gear into the cave. So there's the challenges that are there are just much more extreme than what you would find in normal cave diving. Sump diving is almost a totally different sport. The gear is different. The main difference are the tanks. We're using carbon fiber tanks. Typically you'll see them on firefighters. They weigh 12 pounds when empty, so they're really light, so easy to move, get into the cave. When they're full, we do push them up to 6,000 PSI, so it's a lot of pressure. And I think they weigh about 24 pounds at that point. The problem is we have to add lead to them because they're still buoyant. So we have 18 pounds each that have to be added to the tanks to make them negative. Luckily, the lead stays in, so we don't have to carry that back out. As a cave diver, I'm not too worried about the dive. It's coming out afterwards. Will we be cold after that dive? Probably. We do have it set up to where we can sit in a tent and stay warm and have a warm meal and whatnot. But then you have to climb out 1,200 feet. Back in Texas, there's really not a lot of vertical work to do. There's quite a few pits, but nothing to the scale of main drain by any means. We tried to recreate some of the rebelays that you run into here in main drain in some of the trees that we have back in Texas. And really just getting on rope and climbing, because that's really where it's at. It's the physical fitness and trying to stay strong and everything to get out.
Kind of pertinent to this cave, I've done wet caves like Honey Creek and whatnot. I've done deep caves, you know, 400 or 500 meters deep, some down in Mexico and over in Slovenia. Done alpine caves over in Slovenia, but never quite something like this where you put it all together: the deep, the cold, the wet, and the just grueling pace that you have to keep. Because honestly, none of the stuff we're doing in there is particularly difficult. When you don't add the cold wet on top of it, it's not that bad. But you add the cold and wet on top of it, and it adds a whole new dimension of pain and emotional trying. And it just, I don't know, every time I come out of there, I just wonder why I just did that.
Welcome back. Is that you, Matt?
Yeah. My cheery self.
Good to see you again.
Yeah, it's good to be up here. I won't lie, I was done with this cave before I hit Frayed Knot.
Oh man, dude.
I took a bad fall, well, bad fall. My foot and handheld hold broke and I fell 5 feet and went around my rump.
Oh shit, dude.
Then, during the meanders, you know that awesome little climb where you have to have the rope pad in the right spot? It wasn't. It broke on me.
No shit.
I don't know what I did or how I did it, but like I yanked my ascender up there and like grabbed stuff, and somewhere in there my troll came off, my upper ascender grabbed, I chimneyed, I went up, caught the lower part of the rope with something, I don't know what. And then I tied it all together so the other two could climb out.
Oh no.
I've had a rough go.
For me, the two hardest parts on the cave are two tighter spots that not everyone else feels is super tight. One's right towards the entrance. It's this little squeeze up that you have to do on the way out. And on the way in, it's not too bad. You sort of slither down it. But coming back out is rough. All your gear catches, you're trying to push a pack out ahead of you, and you just. Honestly, I don't know how I managed it. I was tired when I got to it. I looked at it for a little while, stared it down, tried to psych myself into it, and then just went for it. You grunt, you cuss, you scream a lot, and then it's done.
Ropes over here are really thick, and I mean, if you're not heavy, you won't move with a rack. So with a micro rack, that's what I used. So I changed my technique and using a petzl stop or a petzl simple, and a Cyric, which was kind of and a Rammer carabiner. So that was a little bit different. Also the PVC suit, just in general, you have a PVC suit to avoid water splashing. And you also like using a lot of layers of like Polypro and double pants and like this neoprene socks. So all of that, I've never used that on a cave before. So that was a very different thing that you feel like you're entering like a outer space, you know, with all this gear and like hoodies and all that. Now, I think that a good advice would be, you know, treat the cave really humbly, because it definitely, it's not an extremely difficult cave. It's technical, but I think that with a little bit of training, people can do it. But I think that the important thing about this cave is like, if something small goes wrong, it goes very wrong. And it's just working very well as a team, being cautious about everyone around. And it's good in a case like this, if you're gonna do fully, like what they recommend us to do, that was like, do a first section of the cave, do a pre-trip, see if your gear lines up, because how you feel in your body is gonna be very important. Just how your gear, you know, how you feel, how cold, how hot, is way good advice, you know, to try first a little section to feel, and if you feel good, go back and then go do a full trip. And my pre-trip experience, we came here around June, I think, and we found all these beautiful things full of freaking ice. And I've never hiked on ice before. So I was like, I got there and I was like, what is this white thing going around? And then getting into the cave, I mean, it took away all my fear. You know, at the beginning it was all about, you know, oh my God, you know, Maindrain. And I said, it's a serious cave, but I was putting it over here, over my head. So the moment that I did this pre-trip, it gave me a lot of confidence. I realized that my gear was right. I realized that I can use the pencil stop and everything. And so it gave me a little bit of boost in the way of doing it. The project, I was so glad to be part of this project. I think that doing a serious cave like this with a lot of people that I love, you know, all the Texas cavers and cavers that we met from Sweet and Nick from Utah and Peter and Sean and Mike DeValantis, you know, it was a very good group that we have going on to do a cave like this. And I think a big part of doing this type of caves is also the people you're with. So that was really important, that it was just such a nice environment, and we're always joking around. And even though we're having a bad time on the cave, we're all like coming out and playing music and being at the campfire. And also, I mean, a good thing about this cave is this, you know, Tony Grove Lake is just a little gem that I would never ever come here if it wasn't for the cave. But now that I was here, I was like, oh my God, this is so beautiful. You know, being up there in the meadows and being all these like alpine cars, you know, all these cars going around, and you're sitting down in front of the cave and you look all this view and you're like, oh my God, you know, this is the things that I think I put also really, really important with caving, that it takes me to places that otherwise I would never been.
We do not know the cheer. So we looked it up and we decided, all right, we're going to memorize it. That's going to be the cheer for this weekend. So the very first, within the first few hours of them showing up,
yep. We
jumped it.
What's ratchet.
Amazing is these two memorized it like that.
Ratchet, that shit.
Dordale
Twats, 69 assholes tied in
a
knot.
It's a perfectly reasonable way to start a chant.
This is shit.
Fuck. Okay. One more time with feeling, please. Ready?
She's serious.
She's for real.
Ready? Go.
Wait, right here.
No, you.
You start.
You're the leader.
One, two, three. Ratchet, dirty old fuck. 69 assholes tied in a knot. Hooray! Let's go chant. Fuck!
Keeps on burning.
I don't know where I'll be tomorrow.
I think from the hauler perspective, it went really well. Really smoother than I expected it to. I expected us to have more problems. But, I mean, we did take an extra day.
Yeah, we were supposed to dive on Monday, but that didn't happen because all the gear didn't get down to the sump yet. So set the schedule back a day, which already was kind of cutting into our time to potentially fix problems that did happen.
Yep.
And then at the sump, we had a few things go wrong.
Yep.
Two high pressure hoses leaking at different times. They kind of busted and we had to sort that out, which ended up silting up the sump on the first dive a lot. And then I think the previous explorers, the Thorntons, they had laid some line in there, but it seemed like maybe the flow or something had broken up the line, so it was disconnected and kind of just a little bit of a mess.
Yeah.
So it took basically a dive to sort that out and to get to the end of their exploration.
Here, you have to have a buddy, I think, nearby. Mm-hmm. You have the thermals, you have so many layers going in just to stay warm. You're using dry gloves, so your fingers don't even work properly, the clips and everything. So, it was really nice the first dive we did. We had two helpers, Justin and Bevan, there, and helped us with problems and whatnot. For the second dive, we just planned it since we were going to be alone, and we would help each other out, and we did that, and it went pretty well. I mean, mm-hmm. It can be expected.
Yeah.
Only a couple leaks.
Surveyed about a little under 400 feet, and then we were getting close to our out time because we had some haulers waiting for us. And so the last about 150 feet, we just ran up ahead and just to see what was going to happen next, and it sumped.
Really, it's just you think of it one step at a time, you know, get to the sump, do the dive, and then one drop at a time on the way out. It was more difficult than I thought it was going to be. The dive went fairly well on the second day.
Yeah.
First day, we just had some hiccups, which is not uncommon, you know.
Yeah, definitely. For me, it was hard to let go of the expectation of, or rather of just imagining the project as a whole, and it just seemed like there were so many little places for things to go wrong and not work out well, that for me, I think the hardest part on that was letting go of that big overall objective, and like he was saying, just focus on one thing at a time and get that one thing done. And if each of those little things can happen, you know, the sum of it can happen, but it was hard to imagine the sum of it all at once. Yeah, I think we've both been eating, drinking, sleeping, and breathing this project for quite a few months now, so it'll be nice to just sort of step back and kind of bask in it for a little bit before figuring out exactly what our next steps are. And we're looking forward to talking to the people that, you know, really made all this happen. Swede, Peter Hartley, the folks that have been working on this project for way longer than we have, in order to just kind of help, you know, give our opinion and our ideas about the best way forward. But really, it's these guys' project, and we're just really glad to have been a part of it.
In a couple weeks, I'll look back and think it was a lot of fun.
Oh yeah, this is what you call type 2 fun.
Type 2 fun. It's type 2 fun.
Not like type 1 fun, where it's like, wee, this is fun in the moment, but where it's like, oh, in the moment, this is just kind of really hard and difficult and painful, but then a couple days later, you're like, wow, that really gives me a sense of accomplishment, and that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
It's a sense of accomplishment every time you come out of this place. You come out and you're like, you're the only person who knows. You and the group of people who've done this cave are the only person who knows what you've done. And I've yet been challenged like this, except here. The wheel in the sky keeps on turning.
If you know Andy Armstrong, this will sound familiar. And I said, what are you telling me, Andy? Why are you looking at me like that? Because I'm the only one stupid enough to go out there and haul tanks out. And he said, oh no, there's plenty of people that are that stupid. You'll have all sorts of company. So we're cavers. We do silly things, right?
Yeah. How do you respond to people who are incredulous? Why do you do this?
Yeah, I mean, it's tough. I don't even know that I could answer it in words. It is one of those things that, If you can't put it into words, I'm probably not going to be able to convince you. You know, if you don't kind of feel or have this urge to do these kind of things to begin with innately, I'm probably not going to, you know, be able to write a nice neat paragraph that's going to convince you that what we're doing is something that's fulfilling or breeds contentment amongst ourselves. You know, I think those people are still always going to be incredulous. And that's okay. Plenty of other people do a lot of stuff that I would never spend my time doing, so. Takes all kinds.